angel came to see Mary. She was doing laundry, and then the angel just appeared and she was really scared. So Gabriel was like, Mary, you're gonna have, Mary, you're gonna have a baby. You're gonna have a baby and you will call him Jesus. And then Mary was like, I'm not gonna have a baby yet. I'm only a teenager and I'm not married. Then the angel Gabriel told Joseph that Mary is not lying. You are having a new baby. And so they met up. They went to Bethlehem, which was Joseph's old town.
They ride a donkey.
I don't know.
A camel.
Oh, yeah, a camel.
She said, this donkey's fast. They tried to go to a hotel and
they asked the keeper for a place to stay. The keeper said,
we have no rooms. Literally, no rooms.
So Mary and Joseph walked away sadly, but then he said,
the only place and here in Bethlehem that you can stay is a stable. And then he just pointed the way and they followed. When the shepherds were taking care of the sheep,
then they saw angels.
The angels said, a new baby is getting born, who is king of the Jews.
The angel were singing.
And then the shepherd said, I think we should go there and meet him. The second, I think, said, yeah, I agree with you. And the other said, yeah, me too. They had to walk through a bunch of grass and bushes, maybe have to camp out a night. Then the wise men heard about it.
And then a star appeared.
Well, we should probably follow that star. It's pointing down to the barn.
So maybe we should follow it. Maybe. So the wise men went to Jesus.
They gave them gifts.
A stuffed animal, like a hippo one they have at home.
Some diapers, and some wipes, and some milk, some shoes, some Jordans.
Gold ring and Latimer.
And I don't know how I would survive in that barn. Too stinky, too crowded, and ugh.
I think he probably pooped because the room was very smelly.
Thank you for coming.
He's adorable.
He's gonna be our best friend.
I love you, and you're the best baby I ever seen. There, I said it.
The new baby is gonna change the world.
And change the world he did. Welcome back. My name is Matt, and I'm here to share this very special Kids Church service today with you. Tomorrow is Christmas. It's practically here. I want you to take just a moment to go around the room and share with your teacher the thing you are most excited about for Christmas. Maybe some of you guys talked about opening gifts, or eating way too much turkey, or taking long naps on the couch. Well, maybe that last one was just for me. But in our house, we get really excited on Christmas morning. My kids wake up really early. I make coffee. Then we run into the living room and see what's under the tree. It's such a crazy, fun time to get gifts, spend time together, and share with one another. You know, and as fun as it is to get gifts and eat lots of turkey and even take naps for the parents, there is something even more special that we celebrate on Christmas Day. You guys are pretty smart. Can you tell me what the other thing is that we celebrate on Christmas Day? Jesus' birthday. That's absolutely right. Christmas Day is the day we celebrate Jesus, the Son of God, coming to earth as a little baby. Last Sunday, we talked about just how much God loves us, that he would send his only son in the form of a helpless little baby to live this incredible life and eventually go on to sacrifice himself so that we could live and follow God forever. Do you know what's great about birthdays? Everyone gets to sing happy birthday. So let's take a minute now and sing happy birthday to Jesus. I've asked a few of my friends to help us out so you can sing along with them.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, dear Jesus.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Wow. Great job, everyone. Well, what birthday would be complete without some cake? We thought it would be great if everyone got a cupcake that they could take home for later. So at the end of today's lesson, you'll each get a box that contains a cupcake and a candle. When you get home, and with your parents' help, you can have them light the candle, and together you can sing Happy Birthday to Jesus. One of the other awesome things about birthdays is getting some pretty great gifts. Have you ever received an amazing gift? I mean, the kind of gift that just blows your socks off. The kind of gift that when you finally wake up Christmas morning and run out and unwrap it, you just can't contain your excitement. You just want to tell everyone that will listen about that gift you got. For me, it was my Xbox. Man, when I got that thing, I cuddled up all my buddies just to tell them. I talked about it for days, spent hours playing, and shared it with everyone that came over. And it was just a video game console of all things. But you want to talk about an amazing gift? At Christmas, we celebrate that God gave us the most amazing gift when Jesus was born as a human. He gave us the perfect gift. You know, I struggle to even give good gifts or okay gifts, but God, man, God knows how to give the perfect gift. And so Christmas Day is the day we celebrate Jesus's birth. But Jesus's birthday, or the day he was born, is a little bit different than what we are used to.
This is Mary.
Hi!
You see, Mary was the mother of Jesus, but before that happened, she lived in the town of Nazareth. And she was engaged to marry a man named Joseph.
Heyo.
Hi, Joseph!
Got it.
Mary got pregnant by the power of God.
Wait, huh?
Joseph didn't understand all this at first, but an angel came and told him to still take Mary as his wife.
Yeah, okay.
So he did as the angel said. Not long after that, the ruler of the land, Caesar Augustus, wanted to count how many people were in the land. So Caesar Augustus ordered everyone in the land to travel back to their hometowns so that they could be counted. Joseph's hometown was Bethlehem, so Mary and Joseph traveled from Nazareth all the way to Bethlehem. When they arrived in Bethlehem, they looked for a place to stay.
No, I'm sorry. Oh, man.
But there was no room for them.
What about her?
Okay.
So they stayed in a barn, and while they were there, Mary gave birth to Jesus.
Whoa.
She wrapped him snugly in the strips of cloth.
That'll work.
And laid him in a manger.
Excuse me.
And so the Son of God, the Savior of the world, was born in a barn in Bethlehem.
So, we have the Son of God, born in a barn, surrounded by family and a bunch of stinky animals. But you know, it doesn't end there. To tell the rest of the story, I think I'm gonna need your help though. Can you guys do that? With the help of your teachers, we're gonna play a little game in your class. So here's how you can help me get the story together. Your teacher's gonna hand you out little cutouts of pictures that represent the different parts of the Christmas story. And what you're gonna do is you're gonna organize them as best you can, and then your teacher's gonna check it. And if you get them all right, you can glue them to a piece of paper. And that will actually be there as a good reference or a good point to check and see how the order of the Christmas story happens. So how'd everyone do? Did you get them all right? I'm sure you all did a great job. Well, we know that there were some visitors who came to celebrate the birth of Jesus. The first of these were the shepherds. Did you know that way back when Jesus was born, being a shepherd was a pretty rough job? You spent months outside sleeping in tents or in the open, living on little bits of food or whatever you could scrounge up, and you would go days without a bath. True story. Can you imagine walking into your classroom after living with sheep and not bathing for a couple of weeks? I'm sure people wouldn't be overly excited that you were there. Well, you know, that's actually how the shepherds felt and what they faced a lot of the times when they would go to a town or a village. They were considered like a lower class of citizen and weren't treated fairly by other people. Yet on that night, the night Jesus was born, the shepherds were visited by some pretty interesting folks.
On the night Jesus was born, there were some shepherds in the field keeping watch over their sheep. Suddenly, an angel appeared before them. And a bright light shone all around them. The shepherds were so scared, but the angel said, "Don't be afraid.
Okay.
I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David."
Whoa, what?
The angel told the shepherds that they would find Jesus in a barn wrapped in strips of cloth, laying in a manger.
Okay.
Then the angel was joined by many, many other angels, and all of them sang, "Glory to God in highest heaven, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased." Then the angels returned to heaven.
What just happened?
And the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem."
Yeah.
So they hurried to the village.
You stay there.
And found the baby Jesus laying in the manger.
Wow!
After seeing Jesus, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had told them about the baby Jesus. Everyone who heard the shepherd's story were amazed. Mary made sure she remembered all these things and thought about them often. Then the shepherds went back to their sheep and praised God for all they had seen. The baby was exactly who the angel had told them he was, the Savior of the world, the Son of God.
Can you imagine what it would have been like to be greeted by a heavenly host, to look up and hear this incredible message of the Savior being born? You have to understand just how amazing this message would have been. You see, the Jews had been waiting for a Messiah for over 400 years. Man, and you thought it was a long time to wait till Christmas. This Messiah had been promised to them as the Savior and would free them and set them up as a powerful nation. For the Jew, the coming of the Messiah was a promise from God to them. And God was a pretty solid track record with promises. So when the angels appeared to them and shared the incredible message of Jesus with them, it would have been life-changing. Not only were they being given the most hope-filled message of all time, but the fact that the heavenly host had appeared to the shepherds, a group that was considered to be the least and lowest in society, would have made them feel so much more valuable. You see, because God isn't concerned with where you come from, what your parents do for a living, or how popular you are at school. You are created in God's image, which means that He holds you in the highest regard. So, the shepherds are given this incredible message, a message that will literally change the world and impact eternity. So what do they do next? And why do you think they did it? So the shepherds hightail it to a stable where Jesus is born, and were blown away at what they had witnessed. Here's what it says in Luke 2:16-18. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard this were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. The shepherds' reaction to seeing the Savior was to go out and tell everyone they could find about what they had witnessed. It's kind of like when I talked earlier about getting that gift you'd always been waiting for. All you want to do is tell everyone about it. Anybody will listen because you're so excited. Well, that's how the shepherds felt. Their response to receiving this incredible gift of the Savior Jesus was to tell everyone they could about him. Well, in the story of the birth of Jesus, there's a second group of people that didn't necessarily show up the night Jesus was born, but did set out to find him shortly thereafter.
Bethlehem was part of Judea, an area that was ruled by a king named Herod. King Herod was in Jerusalem when some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking,
"Excuse me,
where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him." When Herod heard that there was another king born in Judea, he was very upset, as was everyone else in Jerusalem.
Yeah, not you.
So Herod called all the important priests and Jews together and asked them where this king was supposed to be born. The Jews knew that their king would eventually come, and it was always told to them that the king of the Jews, the savior of the world, would be born in Bethlehem. So they told that to King Herod. Then King Herod thought of a way to trick the wise men. So he called a private meeting with them and learned from them when the king of the Jews' star first appeared.
Oh, good!
And then King Herod told the wise men, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back and tell me, so that I can go and worship him too."
Okay. Hey, on your way.
But secretly, Herod wanted to know where the king of the Jews was so he could get rid of him. So the wise men went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where Jesus was, and the wise men were filled with joy.
Woohoo!
They went into the house and saw Mary and Jesus.
Hello!
Oh, look! Wow!
And they bowed down and worshiped Jesus.
Wait!
They gave him special gifts fit for the king that he was: gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
So the wise men follow a star, find baby Jesus, and then they meet up with him. It's interesting that the wise men, at least on the surface, were a lot different than the shepherds. Where the shepherds were considered the lowest in their culture way down here, the wise men were actually considered to be really important. Important enough, actually, to go see the king. It just goes to show that God loves us all and wants all of us to know and to love him. It doesn't matter where you come from or where you are in life, he absolutely loves you. Now, we know the wise men brought some gifts to baby Jesus. What did they give to Jesus? And why were these things so important? The three gifts were gold, frankincense, and myrrh. These three gifts were considered kingly gifts and carried with them great value and meaning. The gold was traditionally given to a king. The frankincense was like an incense or a perfume which only royalty would wear. Interestingly, it was also a symbol of godliness or deity. The myrrh was an oil that was used as an anointing for a new king, kind of like when David was anointed by Samuel, way back in the Old Testament. It also, though, was an oil used to prepare a body for burial. Some scholars, those really smart people that study the Bible for a living, believe that the myrrh was given to Jesus to represent what he would go through in his death on the cross in order to save us. But what's really important here is that when the wise men met Jesus, their response or reaction was to give their very best to him. They didn't hold back their finest things for themselves. They gave their very best to the only one really worthy of their worship, Jesus. So what does this all have to do with the Christmas morning, the presents under the tree, and me needing to take a nap opening up all these said presents? Well, maybe not much to do with the nap itself, but it has everything to do with Christmas. You see, Christmas is the season we celebrate the birth of Jesus, who would grow up to do amazing things and even go on to save us from our sins. We can look out to all the examples of the shepherds and the wise men as we think of how we can respond to this good news of the gospel. We have the opportunity to be like the shepherds and to tell others about what we know to be true, that Jesus, the Son of God, came to earth to seek and to save people so that they could live in heaven with him forever. You know, John 3:16 is a great reminder of this. It says this: "God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." What an amazing truth. You see, we today, at home with our families, at school with our friends, can share the story of the amazing gift of Jesus. We can also be like the wise men who gave their very best to Jesus. Did you know that today, no matter how big or small you are, you can give your very best to Jesus? You can serve him by helping your mom and dad at home, by being nice to your brother and sister. I know that one's gonna need some, you know, the help of the Holy Spirit. You can serve him by helping out at church or at your school. You can serve him today, no matter your situation or your circumstance. So today, we celebrate the birth of Jesus, the greatest gift ever given in the history of gift giving. Merry Christmas. With your teachers, let's take some time now and thank God for the incredible gift of his son, Jesus, in prayer. All right, guys, we're gonna play this awesome game now called Christmas Bingo. Here's how it works. Your teacher is gonna hand each of you a card that's gonna have a lot of little pictures on it. And then they're gonna stand at the front of the room and they're gonna call out one of the pictures. If you have the picture on your card, you circle it so that you know that it's marked. And when you get a full row, you win the game. And teachers, if you want, you can keep going with the game. Feel free to continue rolling through, depending on how much time you have to work with. Hey guys, we're gonna play a game called Pin the Tail on the Donkey. It's a really fun game. So how it's gonna work is there is a big picture of a donkey at the front of your classroom. Your teacher is going to have little tails cut out with some tape on them. Now everybody has to stay at their desk and stay socially distanced, but one by one you'll be called up and your teacher will give you the tail and you can close your eyes and you have to make your way over to the donkey and try to stick it as close to the tail as you can. Now teachers, the actual cutouts are laminated so you can do a quick wipe down in between. The tails will need to be thrown out after each child uses them. And kids, we encourage you once you've played, just wash your hands with the hand sanitizer as well. There are enough of the big ones, teachers, if you want to throw them out at the end of your class, by all means, feel free to do that. And remember, no blindfolds, so everybody just has to keep their eyes closed when they go up to pin the tail on the donkey. All right, this game is really fun. This is a snowball fight. Now, obviously you're in a classroom, so there's no snow, or at least I hope there's not. If there is, let me know, because it means I have to fix the roof. But we are gonna play a snowball fight game where your class is gonna be divided into either half or thirds, depending on how many kids are in the room. And teachers, you'll have a big bucket. And each kid is gonna get 5 cotton balls that, remember, can't be reused today, but we can set them aside and use them later on a future craft. So kids, you'll stay in your seat, and you're gonna try to throw your snowballs into your teacher's bucket. Now, it's important that you take turns doing this to make sure you get all or as many of the cotton balls in your bucket as you can. At the end of the game, the team with the most cotton balls in the bucket wins.